Good afternoon, everybody. In fact, I was told to speak on Basamati model, and all of you have seen this film, that's why I don't know what to speak. Mr. Shah started when he introduced me. He mentioned about sports also, and my association with sports. Only my request to him, though I'm closely associated with cricket, but the matter is in Supreme Court now. And court is going to decide how cricket should be organized. Till yesterday, they were guiding us how to run the country. Now they are also guiding to sports organization. And that's why I don't want to say anything about that, because I don't want to face a contempt of court from any court. Anyhow, Shri Harshvardhan Devitya, Shri Rashi Shah, Dr. Mahapatra, Shri P.D. Karandikar, and friends. I'm really, really happy to participate in 89th annual meeting of the FICCI. And I would like to wish a very good year. And this is my wishes from farming community who are spread across the length and breadth of the country in villages. Our agriculture has achieved a high global rank, much higher than the ranks achieved by other two sectors, that is services and manufacturing. However, many times we are skeptical to our own achievement. The economic survey of 2015 and 16 carried an incorrect narrative, and that is, the Indian agriculture is a victim of its own past success, and that it has become a cereal-centric. The fact is otherwise. Between 1975, the dawn of the Green Revolution, and 2014, Indian population has doubled from 61 crores to 122 crores, but the food production increased four times, touching a high nearly 2,270 million tons. Cereal-based production has been sufficiently diversified to embrace horticulture, fisheries, animal production, and several allied agriculture production. In fact, I hope some of you might be knowing, last year certain figures were published, and that has shown that India is the largest producer of the milk in the world. India is the second largest producer of the rice in the world. India is the second largest producer of the wheat in the world, and we are also second largest producer of the sugar. That shows how the agriculture of this country is changing very fast. Early this year, U.S. Department of Agriculture published a report titled India's Agriculture Growth Promoters, where it has stated, since 1980s, Indian agriculture has undergone a shift in production as farmers have planted less area to the food grains and more to the high-value crops. This shift coincides with a strong economic growth, which has boosted income and in turn expanded consumer demand for the higher value food, such as vegetables, fruits, milk, and some milk products. Indian agriculture certainly has prospered, but at the same time, there is a flip side to this story. Even though the agriculture income, forestry, fishery remain the largest sector of the Indian economy, its output share fell from 28.3% to 14% between 1993 to 1994 to 2011 and 12. And more concern is employment share declined from 64.8% to 48.9% during the same period. Still, half of the workforce remain dependent on agriculture. And therefore, progress in agriculture has a direct bearing on the fate of the largest population, the largest proportion of the low-income farmers. To bring economic gain to millions of the farm families, there are some critical issues that needed solutions. And that is what Baramati model is. Let me first tell you that Baramati area falls on the second lowest ISO line called ISO head of rainfall, and historically heavily drought-prone, with an average annual rainfall ranging from 400 to 500 millimeters. Although some attempts were made in the British era to construct riverbank canal, rain-fed farming was almost the norm, and hence the farmers were very poor and many times not able to meet their even food requirements. With the sole objective of improving the farming sector and raising farm income, the Agriculture Development Trust Foundation was established in Baramati. I think that was somewhat near to 1970-71. Four issues mainly were identified. One, low productivity of many dryland crops making farming unremunerative. Two, the marketing system that delivers only a small fraction of the final price to the producer. Three, farm size that has reached unviable level, forcing farmers to look for other opportunities. And four, lack of crop and farming diversification. Low productivity is a function of erratic rainfall, low carbon soil, and low to the no adoption of latest technologies. The very first task undertaken by Agriculture Development Trust was creation of water and soil conservation structures in the region. Between 1968 to 78, the Agriculture Development Trust has constructed 290 percolation tanks, that is small irrigation tanks, in 47 rain-fed villages. It had the greatest socio-economic impact on the life of the farming community because irrigation became possible to substantial area with the dry well getting recharged. Special loans were granted to the farmers to dig wells and promotion of drip and sprinkle irrigation system. This has helped store the rainwater and help recharge of the groundwater sources and optimum utilization of the water. Baramati and surrounding, which were once water-starved villages, is today struggling with a full double sowing crop cultivation due to water conservation measures. Another issue that discouraged farmers for actively involving in farming is market accessibility. And therefore, the local organizations successfully created processing units, markets, and secondary agriculture hub for the farm produce. For example, Cooperative Milk Union was established in 1977 with just 10,000 liters of the initial procurement. The dairy business flourished, and landless farmers started keeping cows for milk production. We never supported buffalo. We always supported cow. A, we can take upgradation program of the cow, their breed, and secondly, generally, whatever the cow eats, substantial portion is converted into milk, and whatever buffalo eats, substantial portion convert into fat. And that is the reason, except India and Indonesia, throughout the world, one can see only cow and cow milk. And that's why we had took a conscious decision just to support and encourage and improve the present breed of the cow, and that has really very useful for farming community. Currently, milk procurement from Baramati and nearest district is about 1 million liters a day. That means about 800 crores goes to the villages yearly. Milk cooperative society has been set up in every village. Bulk coolers which can keep milk in good condition are installed. And another important thing is entire milk is from the cow, as I told, and good veterinary services have been provided to the farmers. Milk processing unit has been set up with the help of private sector, and that unit is producing many products from milk which are known companies. For instance, you must have seen the Nestle milk that is produced in Baramati, Nestle butter, Nestle cheese, Britannia cheese, cheese for the Domino's Pizza, KFC, Pizza Hut, milk powder. The milk powder is also supplied to chocolate unit, which is set up by the famous Italian company of Ferrero Rocher. Some milk processing unit also produce some of the famous juices. You see, we can use the capacity of the milk process for about 8 to 10 hours. Then what to do? So we just clean the entire system and use for conversion of the fruits into juices. And today, some of the famous juices from horticulture products from nearby area, we produce there. For example, you must have seen or you must have used the Tropicana juice. So Tropicana is produced there. There is a company called Dynamics, which is doing this job. Nestle and other companies, they are also producing some of their products, and that is paying better price for the milk and fruits to the local farmers. Recently, one more Italian unit called Vauli, which produces bakery products, with all this, Baramati has become a major agro-milk product hub. Outside this, agro-dairy processing hub has brought prosperity to the area, and Baramati is also producing grapes and sugarcane. Similarly, diversification of table grape to winery is another successful intervention. Nearly 8,814 metric tons of wine grapes are crushed, with a regular export of the grapes has really come down to below 255 metric tons annually to Middle East. On the pattern of grape, farmers have started exporting banana. Baramati has become now a vibrant town and created modern facilities of pre-cooling and cold storages. When the farmer assured the supply to the Middle East of many fruits, grapes, bears, pomegranate, banana, custard apples. Through cooperative sugar factories, we have really changed the overall situation of that entire area. In fact, within 50 kilometers range, there are about 11 cooperative and private sugar mills. The sugarcane cultivation and sugar mills got a fillip and brought employment and prosperity and increased standard of living of the farmers. We are not stopping there. We produce sugar. We also produce ethanol from molasses. And we also use bagasse for cogeneration. So the power is available, ethanol is available, sugar is available, and the combined value of this goes to the farmer, and the total turnover of all these sugar mills is somewhat near to 3,000 crores. Although cogeneration units have been set up with producing power and produce ethanol, the molasses, which is also supplied to the most of the petroleum company. You see, because of that, purchasing power of the farming community has been substantially improved. Because of the new technology, they improved their productivity and production, and that's why they are getting better price. The demand is also changing. If suppose somebody like you are visiting to the farmer, they will definitely discuss within themselves, what should we offer evening? What type of drink you will prefer? And if they know that you are coming from industrial sector, they will go to the shop and they will ask, give me one Shivaji Regal, not Chivas Regal. They know only Shivaji Regal. So their standard has been improved from another to Shivaji Regal. That is a change which we have seen. You have seen here, we also set up a textile park. Textile park, we have not done anything. We have just set up a park, provided infrastructure, and invited people, those who are interested in producing cloth or garments. And quite a big number of units are there. About 8,000 women are working every day, and whatever they produce, that product goes to throughout India and outside India too. Technologies, such adoption to the new cultivars, IPM, INN, GMO crop, diversification, micro-irrigation technologies, fertilizers, fertigation, and such practices require education. And that's why we have set up three educational complexes. One is a Vidya Pratishthan. Vidya Pratishthan consists of about 250-acre campus, about 24,000 students, right from pre-primary. There are CBSE 4 schools, then Marathi medium school, then Marathi and English medium secondary school and CBSE school, Arts, Science, Commerce College, College of Engineering, College for Law, College for Biotechnology, Information Technology. So these type of institutions have been provided, and there's no capitation fee. Whatever the state government fixed the fees, that fees has been charged, and best quality infrastructure and teachers have been provided to the student. Second campus has been set up exclusively for girls. And that is also from pre-primary to post-graduation. About 8,000 girls are studying in primary sector, secondary sector, college sector, and different type of courses which have been provided for the girls. And third campus, about 80 acres, has been set up exclusively for engineering and similar courses. This particular setup or campus has been supported by the essentially farmers. We have cooperative sugar mills. We take a decision in annual general meeting. 2 rupees to 5 rupees per ton has been diverted for this education purpose. the farmer who is getting about 2,500 rupees per ton price to the cane, he will not object to just to pass just 5 rupees for this education setup. And that's why when we crush about 4 to 5 crore ton, it's easy to raise about 20 to 25 crore a year for development of these basic infrastructures. And that money has been collected, and that money has been practically used to set up this type of information infrastructure. This agriculture development has also working a big way in the area of the women. And basically, we have set up one farm science center. It's a scheme of government from India that is known as the Krishi Vigyan Kendra, KVK, for the effective transfer of technologies and implementation of research, finding by ways of extension, demonstration, and education. Today, that Krishi Vigyan Kendra has become one-stop shop for the technology and inputs and services. Women empowerment was identified as a key factor in farm management, and hence specialized courses are organized for the farm women and also give the girls the chance to have education in any field of their choices. One of the most encouraging features of the Baramati model is women participation through self-help group. Initiative taken by the trust in the development of the platforms of the Bhimtari Carnival. It's a jatra, you must have seen. Jatra means the sort of assembly has been organized. People from the around the area has been invited, and those women who produce various of things that has been kept there for sales. We are getting very good support for that. Nearly 500 self-help groups are involved in product development, processing, and marketing. Krishi Vigyan Kendra has been instrumental in educating farmers in diverse fields, from dry land fruit crop cultivation, vegetables, poultry, beekeeping, high-tech horticulture, nursery, development of the desi cattle, buffalo breeding, sheep and goats raising techniques, fisheries, sericulture, animal nutrition units, fish feed, and many such allied professionals. Krishi Vigyan Kendra is serving farmers by of diagnostic labs, soil testing, supply of planting material, integrated farming system, seed and food processing, and customizing of the farm machinery. Coupled with group marketing techniques, farmers are trained in the future training to get a better remuneration of their produce. No rural facility is possible until the farm production to consumption value chain is established by reducing the role of the middleman. The trust encourages formation of the custom hiring center for the farm mechanism to meet out the labor shortage. Farmers producers company or group farming to meet out the small land holding problems. And constant technology delivery through dedicated radio channel, live exhibition, and animal shows. At the bottom of the success of any rural transformation is the creation of enough job for youth in the around their place of living. The trust empowers the youth to start dairy unit, broiler sale, milk cooperative, honey production, para-veterinarian, as an animal caretaker, agri-carpentry, bio-fertilizer units, greenhouses farming, vermicompost production and sale, and so many self-employment opportunities. Even some youth commence the agro-tourism as a profession and earning handsome for good living. Baramati model is exactly opposite what is traditionally thought in sequence of employing farming first. Here, the trust commence with a secondary and tertiary agriculture, which auto-boosted the primary farming and encouraged farmers to introduce more as there was ready market and processing facilities. Again, it is not based on a single commodity, but all the possible crops, animal, fish, and allied activities combined together so that under the natural calamity, they can have a secure earning and living. In the end, I must point that the bringing possibility to the rural folk, time and again suggestions of use of modern technologies, shift into the high-value commodities, getting remunerative prices to the farmers through stitching the torn value chain, and so on the area when suggested by economists. What the Baramati model, despite the actual adoption which transferred the principle of practice, and the results are here for everybody to see. Experience in the field suggests that the farmers need to be freed from restrictions of act and laws of agriculture produce market committees, essential commodities, export-import policies, and frequent changes in them, in the interest of consumers who are more vocal than producers. Recently, I find that Indian agriculture is being brought back to the license and control laws, which is detrimental of the growth of this sector. Government of the day should not have hostility to improve system and technologies and differ from finding faults of the past. Central's control on the cotton export 2014, restriction on export on onion below $700 per ton in 2015, order to control cotton seed price 2015, and fixing sale prices of the cotton seed are considered retrograde steps. Ironically, the cotton seed prices control goes beyond the government's mandate to fix maximum sale price for the Essential Commodity Act 1955 and interferes in the fundamental right of the signed confidential agreement between the private party. It appears that government is overly cautious on the technology front and lack the required central-state coordination for promotion of the new technologies. Rural facilities to the agriculture development rests on the technology platform, and hence, I feel that the choice of using any technology must be left to the farmers. I don't want to take more time. I was told that I should say something about what exactly impact of demonetization in agriculture sector. In fact, let me tell you frankly, when the decision was taken on, I think, 8th of last month, within 3 or 4 days, I left Delhi and visited some villages and some tertiary places. I was asking various cross-section. Let me tell you frankly, immediate reaction was quite favorable. Everybody was saying it's a good step government has taken. Now black money will be covered. And definitely prices of essential commodities will come down, and it's a good sign. When I visited last week, I visited some banks. I met those who are in the queue. I met a group of the farmers. I saw altogether different reaction. Sizable sections in the farming community are very, very unhappy. They are saying, so whatever we produce, which we are taking to the mandis, there is no demand. There is no sufficient money to the buyers. And that's why, for example, the price of the onion, which was there for years together in this one, between 14 rupees to 20 rupees per kilo, has come down 5 to 7 rupees per kilo. And the farmer is saying, see, my transport costs also I'm not getting, so why should I send to the market? I talked to many other people, those who are essentially in vegetables, their reaction is also equally bad. Now, there is an insufficient currency, money is not available. Most of our area is essentially depending on cooperative institutions. We have very strong cooperative banks. The approach of the government of India, particularly after demonetization, is something different regarding these cooperative institutions. I can tell you one thing. I will give the example of my own cooperative bank, Pune, and nearby Satara. These two cooperative banks which come under my own area. The Satara banks, the total bank deposit is somewhat near to 7,000 crores. NPA is 0.28%. Recovery of the loan, average 100%. And that bank is facing tremendous money crunch. Money is not available. Similarly, Pune Bank. The Pune District Central Cooperative Bank, which has recently completed 100 years, that bank's the total deposit in State Bank of India is something about 18,000 crores. Recovery is 98%. NPA is somewhat near to 1.5%. And their daily requirement for rabi crop, because now rabi season is on, is about 5 crore from farming community. That money they provide to village cooperative society, and village cooperative society disburse that money to the farmer for essentially their agriculture cropping season. Now, the same bank, in 2 weeks back, they got from State Bank of India 1 crore rupees for 1 week. Their requirement is 5 crores per day. That bank, whose deposit is with State Bank, substantially with State Bank, and the State Bank has supplied them 1 crore rupees per week. This week, when we make noise here, it has been improved. It's somewhat near to 4 to 5 crores per week. That will definitely affect the entire sowing operation of the rabi, and it might affect the total production and productivity, because if the quality seed is not purchased and used, quality fertilizer is not used, I think that will affect, I hope. We try to bring to the notice of the government and concerned people, they will take corrective action, and whatever the good side of demonetization, that should be known. Whatever the bad side, because of not proper arrangement, should not be remembered. Thank you very much.